Major ji, I want to start this conversation by asking you about something that I feel doesn't get discussed as much as it should, and that is this whole realm of information warfare and psychological warfare. Can you tell us what exactly this means and why should Indians pay attention to it?
Kamal, this is a great question, and within the question there are various answers, which I will try and bring out now. You see, when we talk of a wider spectrum of conflict, which is non-conventional, asymmetric, hybrid, gray zone, somewhere they dovetail, and they are all separate issues, they're all different, but somewhere they dovetail into influence operations. So like Sun Tzu said 2,500 years ago, he said that true victory is achieved by not fighting at all, or words to that effect, where if you can win without fighting, that is true victory. So what they do is that over a period of time, people have realized that while conventional conflict or conventional capability is always going to be there in your hands, because that is the final insurance policy that any country has, that tanks, aircraft, nuclear weapons, these are the final arguments of any state. But under the nuclear overhang, under the nuclear threshold, there is always space either for limited war, which is a conventional war, or hybrid warfare, in which there is no bloodshed, but you can cause a lot of unease to the adversary. And this is where information warfare comes in. And information warfare has got various platforms. It can be there in print. So you find a lot of articles which are against India, false articles, fake articles, in reputed magazines like the New York Times and the Washington Post. And they're totally fake. And I'll tell you why I think they are fake. Because the people who write those articles are the same people who say that nobody is allowed to go into Kashmir. And then they write an article about Kashmir. So how can you write about Kashmir without going to Kashmir? This beats all logic, but they write it and they get space. Similarly, on television, you have various channels who would, both inside the country and outside the country, who would take a certain narrative. And we call them fifth columnists. People who open the doors of the fort from within. This is something that I've been saying, that the doors of India's forts and castles have always been opened from within and not from outside. And lastly, social media. This actually exploded with social media on the scene, in which a lot of people along the way have gone used social media to harm India, to create a certain narrative. All these things come under the ambit of what we know as influence operations. The ability to influence the minds of, if I may use the word enemy country, the enemy country's population, their way of thinking, create pressure. So in India, while everybody has a right to protest, and this is a constitutionally given right, not given by you or me or anybody else, not even by the ruling dispensation, this is given by the Constitution of India, and this right is sacred and nobody disputes it. But you will find the enemy taking advantage of such, protests, whether it's Shaheen Bagh, whether it's the farmer protests. And of course, the farmers have every right to protest. Why not? They're citizens of this country. As long as they're protesting peacefully, which they largely are, I think they're absolutely right in wanting to protest. We can always dispute that, you have been misled, etc. That's another matter altogether. But they have every right to protest. But what the enemy does is take advantage of this situation. And this comes under the ambit of hybrid warfare also. And you mentioned psychological operations, or PSYOPs, as they are known in the military or the armed forces. Again, try to create psychological pressure through various forms of communication. Through various forms of communication, psychological pressure on the enemy forces or on the enemy population to degrade and denude the capability to fight by reducing morale. When you have lost, it is like a classic example is during the Falkland Island Wars, fought between the UK and Argentina. There's this huge psychological weapon used by the UK that the Gurkhas are coming. And tales were told on BBC about how the Gurkhas spared nobody when they came. And there are cases, documented cases, where the Argentinians just ran away. They heard that the Gurkhas were coming and they abandoned their posts. Such was the fear of the Gurkhas. So that is one level of psychological operations. What we are seeing is a mixture of many levels of operations, including gray zone warfare, in which politics is used. So if you look at the Chinese three warfare strategy, I'm sure everybody's heard of it, the three warfare strategy. So you have information warfare, you have media warfare, you have legal warfare, you have all these kinds of warfare which are used, which are not traditionally conventional methods of fighting a war. But people use these methods, and therefore, this is something that India must develop capabilities in. That's what I feel.
Namaste. We hope you enjoyed this Chitti Media content. Please remember to subscribe to us and switch on the notifications for this channel. For our other social media links, more content, and to support our work, please visit citti.net. धन्यवाद, नमस्कार.